Dear students, so let us start chapter number 2 from operating system, that is operating system services. So this is also comes under module 1. So this is my first lecture on this chapter, that is operating system services. So these are the contents that I am going to cover from this chapter. So we'll start the discussion with operating system services. So after that we have user operating system interface, system calls, types of system calls, system programs, operating system design and implementation, operating system structure, virtual machines, operating system generation and system boot. So the objectives of this chapter are, the first one, to describe the services an operating system provides to users, processes and other systems. The second objective, to discuss the various ways of structuring an operating system. The third one, to explain how operating systems are installed and customized and how they boot. Okay, so let us start the discussion with the operating system services. So we know that the operating system is necessary in order to use any system. So whatever the task you perform on a computer system, everything is carried out by the operating system only. So that's why, in order to provide the facilities in order to accomplish the task, the operating system will be providing the several services, and each service is having a particular use. So that's why here we discuss the two set of services that are provided by the operating system. So we'll start with the first set of operating system services. These will provide the functions that are helpful to the user. Okay. So in that, the first service is user interface. So almost all operating systems have a user interface, that is UI. Means here, what is meant by user interface? Means this is an interface that you get on your system or screen whenever you start using the system. Means here it is going to, it's a particular means by which you will be using your operating system. You will be using your computer system. Okay. So again, there are different user interfaces available. So here we have listed three user interfaces. That is, first one is command line interface. That is, in short, it is called as CLI. So command line interface means what happens? So whenever you start your computer system, a small window will appear. So in that window, whatever the task you have to perform through command. So for each and every task, you have to enter a command. And whenever you execute that command, the corresponding task will be executed. So this is command line interface. The second one is graphical user interface. So graphical user interface, in short, it is called as GUI. So graphical user interface means, as the name itself indicates, a lot of graphical entities will be there. So whenever you start your computer system, so lot of visual entities or icons will be there on the screen. So in order to open a particular application, you have to just move your mouse cursor to that location and you have to just double click in order to open that. So whatever the computer system's interface we are using today, so on Windows system, so it is a graphical user interface only. Okay, so the third one is a batch user interface. So this is mainly used for the mainframe computers and the mini computers, so where the processes will be executed in terms of the batches. So this is about the first service that is provided by the operating system. It is user interface. The second service is program execution. So the system must be able to load a program into memory and to run that program end execution, either normally or abnormally. We know that whenever you write a program, whenever you store the program, so usually the programs will be stored in terms of a file, and file will be stored on the secondary storage. So whenever you want to execute that program, first that programming file should be loaded into the main memory so that it will be executed. So for this, whatever the services that are required, so these will be provided by the operating system, so that we call it as the program execution. So after that, whenever you run the program, so after that you have to terminate that program either normally or abnormally. So for that also, this service is responsible, that is program execution. So the third service that the operating system provides to the user is the I/O operations. So we know that we have the number of input-output peripheral devices that are connected to the operating system. So during the execution of your program, if your program want to have an interaction with any of the IO device. So for that, whatever the mechanism that is required, whatever the facilities are required, so these are to be provided by the operating system, and these are through the IO operations service. So the next service is file system manipulation. So the programs may need to read and write files and directories, create and delete them, search them, list file information, permission management, and so on. So during the execution of your program may want to read or write the content to a particular file. During the execution, it may want to create a new file, it may want to delete a file, it may want to search for a particular file, it may want to list the files that are available, and so on. So for all these things, all the file related activities, again the operating system will provide a service. It is through the file system manipulation. So apart from this, we have the fifth service, that is nothing but the communication. So we know that whenever you start executing a program, a process will be created, and whenever the number of processes are executing, so there should be some means by which the processes will be communicating with each other. So it is called, it comes under the inter-process communication. So this is also one of the service that is provided by the operating system. So after that, the sixth service is error detection. So the operating system needs to be constantly aware of the possible errors that may arise whenever you execute a particular program or whenever the processes are running. So it may occur, the different type of errors are possible. The error may occur in CPU and memory hardware. So, or it may occur in the IO devices, it may occur in the user program, and so on. Okay. So for each type of error, the operating system should take the appropriate action to ensure the correct and consistent computing. Means whenever an error occurs, it should not harm or it should not affect the usual operation or usual functioning of your computer system. So the operating system should take the appropriate actions in order to protect the computer system and whatever the executing programs or processes are there, so in order to halt before halting. So in addition to this, debugging facilities should also be provided for the program for the user, so that he will come to know what is the reason for that error, so what caused that error to occur, how to overcome that, and so on. So these are the one set of operating system services that are provided. So the another set of operating system services are there. So these are for ensuring the efficient operation of the system itself via the resource sharing. So whatever the first set of operating system services we saw, the six services we saw, so these are for the user, and the second set of operating system services are for the efficient operation of your computer system. Okay, so again this is through the resource sharing. So here what are the services that the operating system provides? So the first one is resource allocation. So we know that whatever the modern computer system we use, so all are multi-processing system, means the number of processes will be executing at the same time. So these are also multitasking, the number of tasks will be executing at the same time. So in the same way, whatever the resources that the computer systems are having, so these are distributed. Okay, so these are shared among the number of different devices. So that's why here again, whatever the mechanisms or functionalities that are required for this, so these will come under the service, that is resource allocation. So here the many types of resources are there. So these may include the CPU cycles, the main memory, okay, the file storage, and so on. So these will have the special allocation code, and such as IO devices may have the general request and release. So some implementation details are there. So in general, this resource allocation means we know that the resources are shared, and because all the systems are distributed, so for this whatever the facilities are required, so this will be provided through this particular operating system service. So the next service is accounting. So it should maintain the account. Account means what? So it should have the track of the different users. So which user is using which parts of the resources, so how much resource he has used, whether any user is waiting for the particular resource, and so on. So all this information should be maintained by the operating system, and this will be taken care by the operating system service, that is accounting. So after this, the next service is protection and security. So I think in my previous lecture we have already discussed about this, what is meant by protection and security. So protection means this is to protect your system from the internal matters. Security means this is you to defend the system from the attacks. So the owners of the information stored in a multi-user or a networked computer system may want to control use of that information. So concurrent processes should not interfere with each other. So that's what, when we have the number of when we have a particular system, a multitasking system and multi-user system, so the number of users will be accessing the system. So that's why, so there should not be any interference with each other. So all these things should be taken care by the operating system. So along with this, here the protection involves ensuring that all access to the system resources is controlled, and security of the system from outsiders requires user authentication, extends to defending external IO devices from invalid access attempts and so on. So that's what we discussed. So these are the three services that the operating system provides in order to ensure the correct operation of the system. So here in general we have we can visualize the different services through this particular figure here. So here you can see this is the figure of a complete computer system. So at the bottom we have the hardware, above that we have the operating system. Okay, so here this sky blue colored part is entirely represents the operating system part. Okay, so this operating system part, it is going to provide the so many different services. So these services are listed out here. So as we saw, here we have again a set of services, here we have another set of services. Okay, so here what are the services that are available? So here we have the program execution, IO operations, file systems, communication, resource allocation, accounting, protection and security, error detection. Okay, so we have the service of system calls also. So in the next slide we see this system calls and all. So after this, here in addition to this we have the interfaces, that is GUI, batch and command line, and after that we have the user and other system programs. Because see here, this side you consider we have an user. So whenever user want to use this particular system, so here in order to use that, he should have one particular interface. So that's why this interface comes first. So through this interface, the user is able to access these particular services. Okay, so this is how you can view an operating system services. So again, in general, we'll just discuss these things. So the operating system, user operating system interface, that is the CLINO. So the user and operating system, how exactly the interface takes place between the user and the operating system. So in the previous discussion itself, we saw that there are different types of user interfaces available, like a command line interface, batch interface and GUI. So here we discussed two, that is CLI and GUI. So already I think I have discussed about the CLI. So CLI, it's nothing but command line interface. So a command interpreter allows direct command entry. So sometimes implemented in kernel, sometimes by the system programs. So sometimes multiple flavors implemented through the shells. So the primarily it fetches a command from a user and executes it. Sometimes commands built in, sometimes just names of the programs. If the latter, adding new features doesn't require shell modification. So see, already I told you about this command line interface. So if you have this command line interface for a particular system, so a terminal, usually a terminal will be opened, and in that terminal for each and every activity you have to enter a command and you have to execute that command. So all the task will be carried out through the execution of a command only. So where exactly this CLI is implemented? So this, most of the time this may be implemented as a part of the kernel, or sometimes it may be through the programs. So whenever it is implemented in part of a kernel, you take the best example as the Unix operating system. So in Unix we have the different shells. So usually there are four shells, that is corn shell, bourn shell, bash shell and C shell. So each shell will have the different way of implementing this particular CLI. Means in other words, here each shell will have a different interpretation, and it will possibly, it may have the different interpretation of the commands also. Okay, so in this way the CLI can be implemented in terms of the kernel. So another way is it may be implemented through the program only. So here it is given, that is sometimes the commands is built in and sometimes just names of the programs. Means here here the system will be maintaining the set of programs, and whenever a command will be executed, so usually every command will be having an associated program that is to be executed. And here what happens is, whatever the name of the file is there, so with the same name the command will be there. For example, you consider the file rm. This is used to remove a file. So when you try to execute this rm file, what your system will do is, system will search for a program with the name rm. It will simply load that program and you will execute. So whatever the task you want to accomplish through that command, so that is done through the execution of that program. So in this way, the CLI can also be implemented through the programs. So after this, the next is the user interface. How exactly the user operating system interface takes place through the GUI. So GUI stands for graphical user interface. As I told you, everything will be visualized. Okay, so on the screen, so you have the lot of icons. In order to perform a particular task, you should know which icon you have on the screen, and you have to just operate on that icon in order to perform that task. So whatever the computer systems we use today, the modern computer systems, especially Windows operating system having computer systems, so everything is GUI either. Okay, when you start your computer system, so lot of the different visual entities will be there. So through these visual entities only you will be performing your operations. Okay, so that's what here. It's a user friendly desktop made up for interface, usually mouse, keyboard and monitor. So icons represent files, programs, actions here. So the various mouse buttons or objects in the interface cause various actions. Okay, so it may provide the information. So that's what on Windows system, whenever you move to a particular icon, and if you just right click, you'll get a lot of different information from for with respect to that particular icon. So all these things are possible. So the use, actually this GUI is invented at Xerox PARC. So many systems now include both the CLI and GUI interfaces. So in on most of the systems, both the options are there, that is CLI and GUI, and it depends on it is left to the user whether he want to use GUI or CLI. So the examples are, if you consider almost all the Windows operating systems, so we have both GUI and CLI. So whenever you start using whatever the visual things you see, so all are nothing but GUIs. Okay, so how you get CLI? You have to just open the command prompt. Okay, so in the command prompt, whatever the things you enter, so that is nothing but a command shell, that is CLI. So similar to this, on Apple Mac OS X, also we have Aqua GUI interface with the Unix kernel underneath and shells available. So on Solaris is a CLI with optional GUI interfaces, that is Java Desktop and KDE. So this is about the user operating system interface through CLI and through GUI. So here I have just added some of the example snapshot in order to show how exactly the CLI will be there. So this is an example of a CLI on the Born shell. As I told you, here it depends on the different shells. The different shells will have the different representations. Okay, so similarly we have an example GUI for the Mac OS X, because already you know how exactly Windows GUI will be there. Okay, so after this, so now let us discuss about the system call. So what is system call? So we know that the operating system operates in two modes, that is user mode and the kernel mode, that is dual mode of operation. And we know that in the user mode the programs will be having the limited access, but sometimes whenever a program want to have access to the system resources, or when you want to perform a particular task in the kernel space, how it is done? So that is done through the system calls. Okay, so for that he have to call a system call. So whenever the system call is called, so the system call will start execution in the kernel space. Okay, so temporarily the execution pointer will be moved from the user space to the kernel space, and in the kernel space all the lines will be executed, and after that again it will be transferred back to the user space. Okay, so this thing we'll discuss here. So what is the system call? Already we saw, so it's nothing but a programming interface to the services provided by the OS. So that's what here. So whatever the services that are provided by the OS, whenever you want to make use of those, so these are provided in the form of the system calls. So again, in addition to the system call, we have one more like API, that is application programming interface. So actually APIs will be used in the program, okay, and user will be knowing the API, and again internal mapping will be there from the API to the system call. So that we discuss again next. So usually the system calls are written in high level languages, maybe C or C++, and mostly accessed by programs via high level application program interface, that is API, rather than direct system call use. That's what I told you. Okay, so most of the time it will be very difficult to remember the system call, because system calls are in detail. Okay, so you should remember the correct syntax and semantics of that in order to use that. Okay, so that's why in order to ease this particular task, your system will be having the set of application programming interfaces, APIs. Okay, so in your program you have to just remember the API, you have to just call that API. So internally the API will be, there will be mapping between API to system call. So internally the API will call the system call and it will start executing that. Okay, so this will provide us some kind of the platform independence also. Okay, the portability. So there are three most common APIs available. So we have on Windows, we have Win32 APIs. On POSIX, we have POSIX APIs for POSIX based systems, and Java API for the Java virtual machine. Okay. So already we saw why we have to use APIs rather than system calls. So here we have taken an example of the system calls. So system call sequence to copy the contents of one file to the another file. So here whenever you want to copy the contents of one file to the another file, so what are the different system calls that are executed in order to perform this task? So in brief it is shown here. You just see here, one side we have the source file, another side we have the destination file. So source file means the content of this is to be copied and this should be pasted here. Okay, so the example system call sequence here. So whenever you start executing your program, so first you should know what is the input file, what is the source file. So in order to acquire the input file name, so first you have to write a prompt to the screen. So to write a prompt to the screen, we have one particular system call. Okay, so whenever execute that, prompt will be displayed on the screen. So whenever user sees that, he is going to enter the input, so you have to accept that input. So for this again, one more system call will be executed. Okay, so after this, once you know the input file name, so now you have to read the output file name in which you have to paste the contents. So for that again you have to acquire the output file name. So to acquire the output file name, again the two system calls are used. So first you have to prompt a particular screen. So after that, whatever the file name he enters, we have to accept that input. So now you have the input file name also, you have the output file name also with you. So in order to copy the content of this file into this, first you have to open this file. So to open this file, again we have a particular API or the system call. So here in order to open, you will be calling the particular system call, and again it will check whether that file exists. So if that file does not exist, you cannot open any file. So you will simply abort the execution. Means if the file itself is not present, so which file you are going to open? Okay, so that's why you have to simply abort. Okay, so if this is not the case, so it will go for the next line and this will be executed. Because if the file does not exist, it will simply abort, means your execution will halt here only, it will stop here only, the remaining lines will not be executed, remember here. Okay, so the next, this line will be executed only if this condition is false. Okay, so the next, again you have to create an output file. Okay, so to create an output file, again you have to, if the file exists, you have to simply abort that. So after that you have to now perform the actual task. So we have a loop here. So each time you have to read an input, read from the input file, and that is to be returned to the output file. It may be in terms of bits, it may be in terms of blocks, okay, in it may be in terms of bytes also. It depends on the architecture of the system and how exactly the operations are performed. So this loop will be repeated until the read fails. Okay, so after that you have to close the output file. So once you close the output file, you have to write completion message to the screen and terminate normally. So for each and everything, the system calls will be executed, and through the system calls, the different activities will be carried out. Okay. So here I have taken one simple example of the standard API. So here the name of the API is read file. This is used to read content of the file. Okay. So you can see after this read file, in the pair of parentheses, we have to provide the number of parameters. So the first parameter is handle file. So it's a this indicates a unique handler, the file descriptor which indicates from which file we have to perform the read operation. So after that we have LP wide of buffer. So LP wide buffer is a buffer where the data will be read into and written from. Okay, so temporarily whenever you perform the read operation, so that data will be stored in this buffer. So after that D word bytes to read, this indicates how many bytes I want to read. Okay, so LBT bytes read means this indicates the number of bytes that are read during the last read operation, and last one is OVL, it indicates the overlapped IO is being used. Okay, and it is going to return a value that is bool. It indicates either true or false to indicate whether the read operation was successful or not. Okay, so next we'll see the system call implementation. Just a glance here. So it's typically a number of associated with each system call. A number associated with each system call. A system call interface maintains a table indexed according to this number. So that's what here. Actually, there is some sentence mistake here. So here, actually, for the implementation, what the system will do is every system call will be having an associated number. So it will maintain a table, and in that table, the index will be this number associated to each system call. Okay. So the system call interface maintains a table indexed according to these particular numbers. So the system call interface invokes intended system call in OS kernel and returns status of the system call and any return values. So the caller need not know nothing about how the system call is implemented. Just needs to obey the API and understand what OS will do as it is. So that's what the user should not need not to remember what how exactly the system call is implemented and all. If you knows what is that API which can be used for that particular task, it's more than sufficient. So here we'll just see how exactly the relationship will be there between the API, system call, and OS. So as we know, the system call is at the kernel mode. So that's what I told you, the operating system will work in two modes, that is user mode and kernel mode. So user mode means the limited permissions will be there, but during the execution in between whenever a user want to have some task to be done at the kernel mode, so he can call the system call, he can use the system call. But remembering system call name, its a syntax semantics is difficult. So that's why as a replacement we have the concept of API here. So here in the user mode, the user application will be there. So here we have taken an example of the open API. So whenever this user program calls this open API, so here from this user mode to kernel mode to for have the transition, we have the system call interface. So here what it will do is, so this will take care of this particular thing, that is whenever this API is going to hit here, so it will be knowing this particular thing will be knowing to in order to accomplish this which a system call is to be executed. So according to that it will call the corresponding system call. So as a result, your execution pointer will move from this this user mode to the kernel mode. So in this kernel mode, already we saw for the system calls it maintains a table. So this table will be indexed with the numbers that are given to the every system call. So let us consider the number is I. So at ith index, we have the corresponding system call to be executed, that is open. So again, the contents are fetched. So this is the implementation of this open system call. So it will execute all the lines one after the other. So at the end, whenever it executes the return, so it will go back to the system call interface, and from here it will go back to the user application. So in this way, relationship exists between the API, system call, and the operating system. So here we have one more example of a standard C library. So we know that in C also we have the set of library functions. So here we have taken the example of printf. So we know that this printf definition is present in the yesterday.a, so that's why you have to include this. So whenever you execute this temporarily, it will fetch the body of this particular system call, that is printf. So it will be executed, so as a result again it will be displayed. So that's what here the function for you is printf. It is in the user mode, but in the kernel mode the system call for this is write. So when you execute printf, the write system call will be executed, which will print, which will display the message on the screen. Okay, so after this, the last point of today's discussion, that is the system call parameter passing. So the system call parameter passing means, so we know that whenever you call a particular system call, so you have to pass some parameters, okay, so that whatever the input that is required, that will be given through this particular parameters. So often more information is required than simply identity of the desired system call. So exact type and amount of information vary according to the OS and call. So there are three general methods used to pass parameters to the operating system. The first one is, the simplest possible one is registers. Okay, so we'll load the register with the requested value, and through from this register the system will get that information. The second one is, the parameters are stored in a block or a table in memory, and address of that block will be passed as a parameter in a register. Okay, so the parameters are stored in a block or a table or in the memory, and the address of this is passed as a parameter in the register. So the system should read the content of register, and this register it will come to know where that particular parameter is present, and it will fetch. So in the next slide we have an example of this also. So this is second one. The third method is through stack. So you have to push the content onto the stack and by program, and popped off the stack by the operating system. Okay, so in the next slide we have just shown how exactly the second approach is followed. So here in the user program, this is the operating system. In the user program, so here at location X we parameters for the call. Okay, so here we'll load the address X here. So this will be loaded into the register X. So here we have register X. Okay, so when it reads the content of this X, the operating system will come to know that where exactly that data is present. So here whatever the content you read, so based on that you'll come to know that the code for system call 13 is present here. So as a result this will be fetched, okay, and here this will be executed. So here there are two methods. I think the first one is directly through the system call 13. So we have a direct here. So here we have system call 13, this will be executed. The second one is through register. Okay, the address of X is stored in register, and when you read the content of register, you will come to know that it is for system call 13, and as a result this content will be fetched, and whatever the parameters that are required, so these will be stored here. These will be fetched from this location. Okay, so in this way the parameter passing can be taken place for the system call execution. Okay, so with this here I stop for the today's discussion, and the remaining part of this chapter 2 I will discuss in my next video. Thank you.